Oh, Canada. Have any of you been watching the news lately and thought to yourself, what the hell is going on? You can't change the channel without hearing about more job losses, swine flu, the recession, war in Afghanistan, and another election already? What could all of this mean? Well, let's start off with money. Where does it even come from?
Where do I think it comes from? Like it's made? The government?
Money comes from paper.
I believe it comes from trees.
Yeah, exactly.
In the long run, I think it comes from trees. No, I believe money. I'm not 100% sure.
I'm not certain.
That's a trick question. Why?
Well, it's actually an interesting question. The first of all, money is prior to money. It's going to sound like a long answer, but I'm not quite sure I know the nature of your question. But let me see how I can handle it. Thank you. Prior to money, essentially, trade.
It's actually simple. Over 95% of our money is created by private banks. That means there's less than 5% of government-created money. Let's look at the differences between creating the money ourselves and borrowing it from private banks. Creating the money ourselves pretty much just costs the labor to print it and the hard work to back it up. While borrowing money from private banks can cost up to 10 times or more than the principal before it's paid. Don't believe me?
I think that the problem isn't necessarily, in my opinion, that we issued that debt through a competitive bond process. The issue is that the level of spending that we engaged in was not appropriate, and we got into a situation where we spent too much.
This is Canada's federal debt. From 1867 to 1992, we owed $423 billion. However, 91% of this debt is the result of interest on interest, and only 8% of the money was actually used on real things, like goods and services. But now we have to pay back over 10 times what we needed, simply because we borrowed from private banks instead of ourselves. So where do these private banks get their billions of dollars from that they lend out? Nowhere! They just write down a number on a piece of paper and lend it out as if it was money to families trying to put a roof over their heads, students trying to get an education, or governments looking to improve the country. Banks then get paid multiple times back with your hard work. Every time they issue a loan, they are creating brand new money. It never existed before you walked into the bank.
So pretty much like you say, I go into a bank, I say, well, kind of like $10,000 paid for my college. They
Yeah,
say, sure,
here you
here,
go.
let me just go run this off the machine, and then you can pay us back with your hard-earned money.
Right. That's exactly it.
That's pretty crazy.
They just get you to believe that they're lending you what's inside their vaults, but it couldn't be further from the truth.
For instance, banks. Yeah, do banks have the amount of money that they have in reserve? The answer is no.
There's about $50 billion of real cash in Canada. All the private banks combined only have $4 billion in their vaults, or what they call reserves. And yet they've lent out 1.5 trillion, which they then charge interest on.
I think that the amount of money that's held in reserve in Canada, you're right, is pretty low. One of the reasons it's so low is because our banking system is as stable as it is.
Okay. So what would happen if we simply wanted our money back?
We would have a credit crisis, and the system would not be sustainable. So we'd have to reorganize and restructure, which is what happened actually in the Depression. I don't see that happening again.
Yeah.
But theoretically, that's what would happen.
Oh, yeah, that sounds like a stable system.
So isn't it a little bit fraudulent, though, if I were to walk into a bank and they give me a receipt that's I can redeem at any time, but it's only noticed that it would be called fraud if everyone came to the bank and requested their money?
Oh, I'm going to answer your question, but then I want to go back to mine.
Okay.
Because it really is. This is the huge change of the last 5 years. It's not fraudulent. It's not fraudulent. Because everybody understands it, but it is
not. No one really understands.
Well, okay. I mean, those who know about it, knew about it, so it was not fraudulent.
I've talked to the like teachers and MPs, even MPPs, and they had no idea that there was only $4 billion in the vaults, but over $1 trillion is lent out.
Yeah, let me go back. Well, the fact that they didn't know it. They should have.
But really, no one does.
Well, they're quick,
should that be involved a little bit more before we start using money? That we should be told where it is, where it comes from.
Well, no.
Okay, so it's one thing to lend out money you just don't have, but how can you charge interest on nothing, and not just any kind of interest?
Compounded interest.
Here's a fun way to explain the difference between regular interest and compounded interest. Imagine lending someone $1 at the time Christ was born, at let's say 6% interest. Ready? Go!
To everything, turn, turn, turn. There is a season.
Jesus Christ is right. This is especially scary when you consider that all credit cards, loans, and mortgages are all to be paid back with compounded interest. By the way, if you translate the word mortgage to its original language, French, it literally means death pledge, because people will often work their whole lives to pay off their home by the time the banks have made all their money. Interestingly enough, the French Canadians use a different word for mortgage called hypothèque. Probably because no one in their right mind would sign up for something called a death pledge. Could you imagine? So coming back to our analogy on compounded interest, you can probably see why Jesus threw the bankers out of the temple in the New Testament. And look what ended up happening to him. It's interesting how the operation of banks in Canada are all textbook examples of fraud, counterfeit, and theft.
There was no fraud. People should have known. But there really is a problem. And that is that the people who knew didn't stop it.
Now, if I did what these private banks do on a daily basis, I would end up here. Here. Or maybe here. So how come the banks can break the law, but no one else can? Well, it's technically not breaking the law when our elected officials create bogus legislation like what's contained in the Bank Act. It says that banks can lend out as much money as they want without having to have a single dollar.
In 1991, there was legislation passed in the Bank Act that stated that reserve requirements for banks is completely nil. They don't need to have a dollar in their vaults to actually issue out money.
Yeah, I don't know if I could agree with you on that.
Well, maybe you'll agree with the office of Jim Flaherty when they say there is no statutory reserve for banks in Canada.
And not that they don't have no reserves, because they do, but according to the bank...
Can I just take this?
Yeah, yeah.
John Gray? Yeah, go ahead.
I had read that somewhere in the Bank Act of Canada that it was allowed that somewhere between 1990 or 1991 that reserve requirements for banks would be phased out in the next few months.
I tightened them up.
So they have returned to...
I tightened them up. They were eased up, conservatives eased them up in 90 or 91.
Yeah.
And I tightened them up in 95.
So what did you make them... What is the, you what, said
what,
between...
What they are now. What they are now. It's roughly 7 to 1.
Roughly 7 to 1.
But I want to go back to the main question.
Maybe he means he tightened it up so much that it slipped right through his fingers back into legislation. Because although there are other complex regulations that banks still have to meet, our government has given private companies the authority to break the law, which in turn is bankrupting the people and the government itself. And then when our government decides to so-called fix the mess that they created, they simply make cuts to all the programs that we'd like to spend our tax dollars on, and instead direct it towards an inescapable debt.
Anyway, I decided I'm going to get my $5. So I got to go in the bank, right? Which is, it's hard because they're open for like 10 seconds. They're like, ah, and they close. They're never open. But I go in. I get to a teller and I say, I want my $5. So she looks at me up and says, you don't have $5. And what happens? She says, we charge you another $15 for only having $5. So now, you know how much I have? I have negative 10. Negative 10. That means I don't even have no money. I wish I had nothing, but I don't not have any money. I don't have it. I can't afford something that doesn't cost anything. I can't afford it. If somebody goes, hey, it's free, take it. I can't afford that. That costs nothing. That's more than I need $10 to be broke.
So on a daily basis, how much exactly are we spending on this pointless debt?
Like 100,000, maybe more than that.
We spend $160 million every day.
Are you serious? Oh my god.
Yeah.
That's right. According to Statistics Canada, both federal and provincial debt combined, we're paying $160 million each and every day, or $60 billion every year. Let's put all this into perspective. The largest counterfeiters in Canada produced $3.5 million and were sentenced to 5 years in prison. The largest bank robberies in Canada, committed by the Stopwatch Gang, stole about $15 million and got 16 years in prison. As a result of borrowing from private banks, $160 million goes missing every day, and no one even gets fired.
So what you're saying is pretty much the banks that are in Canada that are chartered by Parliament and all that,
yep.
By Parliament,
yep.
Are pretty much just robbing the Canadian government and in turn the Canadian citizens, because they're causing us to have a higher tax rate than required.
Yeah, exactly,
you know, just to dig into their pockets and get themselves a little bit richer.
So what could you do with $160 million every day?
Oh my god. What I would do, I would pay off my school, I would pay off my parents' mortgage. Like, holy, I'd go on like 10 trips.
Let's start out with $160 million for a lifetime. Never mind a day, buddy, because right. I'd be in a forever party.
Well, actually, no idea, $160 million, like that's so much money. I wouldn't even know what to do with that.
You'd become pretty selfish, I think, right? You'd be self-centered, that's for sure, because you wouldn't have anything to care about.
If you really wanted to, you could buy the Maple Leafs franchise just after a few days and still have millions left over to party with. Probably to try and forget that you bought the Leafs franchise. Or you could buy enough beer to keep the whole country wasted 24/7. I think we'd get a lot of votes for that.
I got an idea. How about as an incentive to pay off the debt, we start stacking the payments with $100 bills and create a new national monument? Think about it.
The CN Tower stands about a quarter mile high. If we stacked our debt using $100 bills, we could create the first ever money tower, totaling 540 miles high. That would dwarf the CN Tower, and it may help with our space exploration. Talk about a tourist attraction. But let's not get over our heads. First things first, we have to change this picture. Because federal and provincial debt combined, we still owe about $800 billion. Plus, every time we make those $60 billion payments, a good chunk of that goes to compounded interest alone. In other words, when we make these $60 billion payments, we may only see about $50 billion taken off. And when you think about how we've already spent about $1.5 trillion over the years on a debt that we still have, any new debt our government gets us into turns into that number times much more. I know some of you may be asking, why on earth would the government keep digging themselves a hole of debt to get out of debt? Well, obviously you don't come from Canada. You see, in Canada, when we dig ourselves into a hole, we don't use anything innovative like, let's say, a ladder to get us out. No, we just keep using the same shovel that got us there in the first place. I guess we figure that since the Earth is round, we should get somewhere eventually. So, we just keep digging. Keep digging until we find ourselves in a whole new world. And even if it looks scary, we're told it's the only way.
Is there, would you say, a fundamental problem? Is there an underlying problem in the monetary system, or is this the way it should be?
No, I don't think there's an underlying problem in the monetary system. The credit is a good thing.
Okay, well, how's the rest of the world doing then? What? The Earth is $52 trillion in debt? To who, Pluto? Guess again.
Okay, so the money system in Canada clearly doesn't benefit the people. Why hasn't anyone told us about this?
Once a nation parts with the control of its currency and credit, it matters not who makes that nation's laws. Usury once in control will wreck any nation. Until the control of the issue of currency and credit is restored to government and recognized as its most conspicuous and sacred responsibility, all talk of the sovereignty of Parliament and of democracy is idle and futile.
Who are you?
Well, I was only the 10th Prime Minister of Canada.
Whoa. Well, you definitely won't hear any of our current politicians say something nearly that profound.
Yes. And now I'm ironically on the $50 bills.
That sucks, man.
Tell me about it.
Well, that's just one Prime Minister of Canada's thoughts on money. No big deal, right?
The privilege of creating and issuing money is not only the supreme prerogative of government, but it is the government's greatest creative opportunity. The government should create, issue, and circulate all the currency and credit needed to satisfy the spending power of the government and the buying power of consumers. By the adoption of these principles, the taxpayers will be saved immense sums of interest, money will cease to be master, and become the servant of humanity.
You too, Lincoln?
For once, someone listened to what I said.
Sorry, I just never read those statements in any school textbooks before.
I made it clear that my greatest accomplishment as being president was that I killed the bank. And yet I too am ironically on the face of everything I was so passionately against.
And then the private banks put your faces on their corrupt money? No offense, guys, but that's incredibly disgraceful.
Especially after being assassinated.
I'll say.
I managed to escape.
Right here, buddy.
Whoever controls the volume of money in our country is absolute master of all industry and commerce. When you realize that the entire system is very easily controlled, one way or another, by a few powerful men at the top, you will not have to be told how periods of inflation and depression originate.
Hey Garfield, weren't you president for only like 4 months?
Well, I was killed shortly after making that comment.
Oh yeah, good point. Well, anyone else?
I myself prefer my New Zealand eggs for breakfast!
Isn't it kind of sad that we have to dig up what our dead leaders had to say about money, instead of trusting the ones that are alive and in office today? I mean, we've seen how little they know about how the system works.
So do provincial governments ever borrow money from, say, chartered banks?
No.
No?
No.
That's just federal?
No. As far as I know, I couldn't tell you offhand.
And it's just, I just don't know why the government doesn't just borrow money from the Bank of Canada, as it states, like, in the Constitution and in the Bank of Canada Act, that the government has the right to do such things to prevent, things like debt from happening.
Well, it's, you may know more about it. Obviously, you've researched a little bit more than I have.
I know that they have a ratings on their basis, which, when they do borrow funds, they get an interest rating. And yeah, they will borrow money from banks.
Now, Canada is like the fly in the ass of an elephant in terms of the overall importance in the world.
Well, I'm not an economist. The Prime Minister is.
Let's be clear about what the situation is. We have not been following the same policies as the United States. The economic and financial mess in the United States is disastrous. The policies have been irresponsible. We've made very different choices in Canada. We have a budget that's in surplus, not a budget that's in deficit. We're paying off debt in Canada, not adding to our debt.
Are your policies working?
I would say that overall we're being successful. We're keeping the economy on course. We're not going into a recession. We have a slowdown. But we are not in the kind of economic crisis we have in the U.S.
And the world is entering an economic period unlike and potentially as dangerous as anything we have faced since 1929.
What happened that me, normally a very staid banker, will lend you the money to buy a home that you don't think?
Well, first of all, is it actually money that they're lending people?
Oh yeah, they're money. They're lending you money.
Is it actual money or is it?
It's real money.
It's not a receipt to present money?
No, it's real money.
Isn't there a difference between bank credit?
Well, yes, there is, but let's go back. Don't change the subject.
I know economists will say, well, we could, you know, run a small deficit, but the problem is that once you cross that line, as we see in the United States, nothing stops deficits from getting larger and larger and spiraling out of control.
Okay.
But wait a minute. Unless you want to get, you're asking me what was the cause of the current crisis.
I just want to know where money comes from.
Well, let me tell you something. Let me just take it one step further, despite the fact that's not where you want to go.
I don't think we've necessarily lost control of our currency, and there are always restrictions in a global market in terms of how much control you have over your currency.
But I want to go back to the the real thing is. This is really the gen. You'd asked the question at the very beginning, but the financial crisis that we're in.
Well, it was just where does money come from?
But it's really important to understand.
We don't agree on everything, but he understands that, I think everybody understands that Canada's a sovereign country, and whether it's dealing with the United States or dealing with China, the fact that a country's a lot bigger doesn't stop us from standing up for our interests and values.
Still need convincing about how ridiculous the monetary system is? It costs 4 cents to make 1 cent, which makes no sense. Or would it make sense to make no sense? Well, this brings me to my next question. Who physically prints our government dollar bills?
The money itself is printed by the Royal Canadian Mint.
The Royal Canadian Mint and the Bank of Canada?
No, the Bank of Canada. Bank of Canada is responsible for monetary policy. But the actual physical production of dollar bills and $5 bills, and we no longer have dollar bills, but of bills and denominations and coins is by the Royal Canadian.
Okay.
Mainly in Winnipeg.
Okay, new rule. If you control the nation's money, you should probably know who prints it.
I spoke to Finance Minister Jim Flaherty, and I asked him, where does money come from? Like, who physically actually prints the dollars in Canada? And he told me it was the Canadian Mint.
Yeah, the Canadian Mint. The Canadian Mint prints the dollars and prints does the coins.
But I thought it was the Bank of Canada that contracts the work to print.
The Bank of Canada is the central bank, mm-hmm. But the Mint is responsible for providing the currency.
Then why does it say on the Bank of Canada's website that they are the country's sole banknote issuing authority? Let's try calling the Mint and ask them ourselves.
Do you guys have anything to do with printing the dollar bills in Canada?
There is a dollar bill in Canada.
But does the Canadian Mint have anything to do with printing dollar bills in Canada?
No.
None?
No. That's the Bank of Canada. Do you want me to get your phone number?
Oh, you may want to tell that to the Finance Minister.
Pardon?
I said you may want to tell that to the Finance Minister. He doesn't know.
Okay, so, sorry, I didn't know about that.
No, it's okay. So just maybe make a memo for him, though.
So it is the Bank of Canada who's responsible for printing our dollars, but they don't do the actual printing themselves. They contract the work to two private companies, the Canadian Banknote Company and BA International, which as of 1999 was bought by a privately owned multi-billion dollar German company called Gysek and Devrient. I'm not even sure if I'm pronouncing that right, which is scary considering that they're in control of printing our dollars. A few things about this German company Gysek and Devrient. They're the second largest banknote printing company in the world, and they've been involved with the printing of banknotes for two separate countries suffering from periods of hyperinflation. What is hyperinflation? Well, imagine going to the store to buy a loaf of bread on sale for $20 million. That's hyperinflation. So much money is printed that it completely devalues the dollar and prices rise dramatically because of it.
That's gonna be $20 million.
Whoa! What are you, a bank or something?
Here's a coin commemorating Germany's hyperinflationary period in the 1920s, where it's inscribed that a single glass of beer was worth $4 billion. Hyperinflation had destroyed the German dollar so much that people were actually using money as wallpaper. And who was getting paid to print all the ridiculous amounts of money this whole time? Or more recently, they were printing money for the country of Zimbabwe and their hyperinflated economy. At one point in the 1980s, the Zimbabwean dollar was actually worth more than the US dollar. But since the dictator of Zimbabwe ran his country into the ground and commanded the printing of trillions and trillions and now quadrillions of dollars backed by nothing, the conversion now is 12 billion to 1. In this photo, a few eggs are on sale for $100 billion. This guy right here is going to buy a burger and fries. So if you feel safe having millions or even billions of dollars in the bank, just remember that at a flick of a switch, the private banks can water your money down until it's worth virtually nothing. All it takes for them to do is keep printing money and everyone is poor. As for GISEC and Devrient, countries all around the world seemed outraged over the printing of all this money for Zimbabwe. In June 2008, US officials announced they would not take any action against the firm that is providing key support to Zimbabwe's brutal regime and is also an important contractor to the American government. Yes, even the US government is admitting how morally inappropriate it is to support Zimbabwe's brutal regime by printing these dollars. But they won't do anything to stop it that might compromise their own business with GISEC and Devrient. But hey, it's business, and in business there are no morals. You should all know that by now. But on July 1st, 2008, after only a few years since Zimbabwe's hyperinflation started to snowball, GISEC and Devrient finally decided they would no longer print banknotes for Zimbabwe, after their own government of Germany officially told them to stop.
The reason for the sale to the German company arose out of the fact that it the need counterfeiting, especially of higher notes, is a problem, and it was going to be very expensive for the Canadian company to, in fact, have the machinery that would produce whatever the heck it is that goes into the bills that prevents counterfeiting, and that's the reason why, in fact, the German company came in.
The point is that Canada should never have let something as important as one of its banknote printing companies to have been bought by foreign companies who support racist dictators. And the excuse to save money is ridiculous when you recall the $160 million every day the government allows to go down the drain.
I'm just wondering if there should be like an institution that the Bank of Canada owns that's job is to print money. And
well, that would be, that would make more sense, yeah.
Let's try to recap everything we've learned so far. The Canadian government creates the phony laws necessary to give banks the power to create and manage money for the hardworking people of Canada, apparently for our benefit. However, the money that's created by these private banks is made and backed by nothing, and attached with compounded interest. It's then lent to teachers, students, workers, and families who now have to pay back the banks what was made from nothing many times over with hard work. This creates a debt-based economy, since the majority of money that now circulates was created from a mortgage or some other kind of expensive loan. When an employer pays an employee, it's not actually money, but someone else's debt. In other words, we're trading debt, not money.
Okay, so you wouldn't be for creating a debt-free money system?
No.
Would a debt-free money system be good for the country or no?
No, it wouldn't. It wouldn't.
I think we'd be better off without a public debt.
What's wrong with everyone? Have they all lost their minds?
In that sense, is a debt-free or debt-based money system, is that healthy for Canada, do you think?
Healthy in the short term, because the alternative is that if you try to balance the books today, you will in fact tip the scales very much in favor of a depression and deflation.
Thank you. Well, luckily for Canadians, we have a way to fix these problems very easily.
The reality is the Bank of Canada has, by legislation, the ability to make whatever money is needed, to loan money to the Government of Canada without interest.
The Bank of Canada, as it's stated on its official website, is ultimately owned by the people of Canada and has the power under the Canadian Constitution and the Bank of Canada Act to lend money to the government at no interest. And if there is interest to be charged, it would just come back to the people anyway, since we own the bank.
I must admit, I'd rather pay interest to myself than, you know,
exactly.
In which case I'd probably cut myself a good deal, you know.
Yeah, we never should have privatized our debt and turned it over to the private banks. We should have kept it in the hands of Bank of Canada, at least a major part of it, because then we would have been paying interest back to ourselves.
John, you can borrow from your savings account and I won't charge you any interest. Good.
And unfortunately, the Liberal government and the Conservative governments both are too close to the banks. The banks wanted the business and they managed to convince the government to privatize that debt, and of course now they're the ones getting the benefits. That's why you notice that they're still very profitable even though everyone else is suffering.
Here's a rough example about how money in Canada should work. The Canadian government realizes it needs money to help make the country work. So it creates the Bank of Canada, whose sole task is to create and manage money for the people. The government then creates what's called a treasury bond, which is simply an IOU, a piece of paper promising to repay the amount of money that it borrows. This IOU is then given to the Bank of Canada, who then creates the money, the same way private banks do, out of nothing. But since it's owned and operated by the people of the country, there's no reason to charge any interest. The government can now distribute the money, which creates jobs. The people can now pull some of their money together and pay off the debt owed to the Bank of Canada, the People's Bank. After the first payment or so, since the Bank of Canada will have to pay its workers and fulfill its job to regulate money, our tax dollars will inevitably circle back into the country, so no new money is required to pay off the debt. And since there is no compounding interest, the debt will never grow, and we'll be able to pay it off very quickly. And once it's paid off, we'll be able to spend our extra hard work, time and money on other things to help better the country.
Oh, I don't need to hear the lecture. I know all of this stuff.
Okay, well,
sorry, I'm not. Don't mean to be rude, but I don't. Just ask me your question.
Okay. Well,
and I'm not that knowledgeable on monetary policy, and the Green Party policies have not moved into the, have not yet adopted the monetary policy that some of our members would like, which is one which would say we should get rid of the loans that we owe commercial banks and transfer that to the Bank of Canada and pay it off with a Bank of Canada loan and then cancel the debt.
Well, they both seem to know a lot about the monetary system to me. And yet last October in 2008, when the central topic in the federal election was about the economy,
we made a decision to give priority to an issue dominating the news and people's concerns these days, the economy. So there will be an expanded debate on that.
Not one single mention was made from any one of the parties about the monetary system, even from the ones who clearly knew about it. But if we go back to the 2006 federal debate, no one would shut up about the $100 million missing from the sponsorship scandal Paul Martin was involved with. But when $160 million goes missing every day, it's no big deal. Look, this is a mutual problem that every party should agree on fixing. And yet in the most important broadcasted debates prior to our elections, it's not even mentioned once. So coming back to the Bank of Canada, is there really any logical reason why we don't use it?
What would make the government want to borrow money from private banks instead of the Bank of Canada?
It should deal with the Bank of Canada, period.
That's coming from a former finance minister and later prime minister. Let's compare that to Paul Martin, who shares the exact same titles.
Does the prime minister or president of either Canada or America have the ability to create debt-free money?
Absolutely,
okay. Because I was reading a quote
by... But you've got to ask the question, why don't they?
Why don't they, right. Why don't they?
Because it's inflationary. Because it'll drive inflation through the roof.
How's that?
Well, here are my glasses. It's the only pair of glasses in the world, okay? And I'm going to sell them for a dollar, right? And you have a dollar, and you don't have any money at all. Or no, you have $10, and you don't have any money at all. These glasses are on sale for a dollar, okay? So you come to see me and you want to buy the glasses. I say, okay, fine, how much will you pay me? And you say, I can't pay any, I don't have any money. So I turn to you and you say, well, fine, I'm the only buyer, I'll pay you a dollar, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Let's say the glasses are on sale for a dollar today and you both have $10, right? So you come to me and you say, and you both desperately want my glasses. So you say to me, I'll give you a dollar. And I say, well, okay, they were for sale for a dollar, but what will you give me? What are you going to say to me? You're going to say
$2.
Sure. Okay. All of a sudden, these glasses, which were worth $1, are now worth $2. That's inflation. Mm-hmm. And that's inflation. The more money there is in supply, the danger there is there's going to be inflation. That's why everybody says what's happening now as a result of what's going on in the United States is that 5 years from now, we're going to have massive inflation.
So it is the amount of money in circulation that causes inflation, not who distributes the money, right?
It's largely the amount of money in circulation. There are a lot of reasons, but it's, yes, that drives up the price. That drives up prices because more people can afford to buy something.
Okay, I'm going to replay the last few seconds of that. Remember, he began saying that it was borrowing money from the Bank of Canada that would cause inflation.
The more money there is in supply, the danger there is there's going to be inflation. That's why everybody says what's happening now as a result of what's going on in the United States is that 5 years from now, we're going to have massive inflation.
So it is the amount of money in circulation that causes inflation, not who distributes the money, right?
It's largely the amount of money in circulation. There are a lot of reasons, but it's, yes, that drives up the price. That drives up prices because more people can afford to buy something.
I think what he's trying to say is now that he's allowed the private banks to make up this magical money that keeps growing in their favor, the government shouldn't borrow money from the Bank of Canada since they would have to create new numbers that don't already exist. But if the Bank of Canada had just been doing its job from the start, it wouldn't make a difference anyway. Do you see how absurd it is to say that the Bank of Canada causes inflation? Besides, since 95% of money is created by private banks, they're the cause of 95% of inflation. Because of the decisions made by prime ministers like Paul Martin, this is how money in Canada sadly works. When the Bank of Canada receives the Treasury bond, or IOU, from the government, they forfeit their duties to create and manage money themselves and instead hand it over to the private banks. The private banks can now lend their debt-based checkbook money to the government. Compounded interest inevitably takes its toll. And this leads to unfair taxes on the people of the country who have done nothing wrong. And when we need real physical cash to trade smaller amounts of money, the Bank of Canada contracts the work to foreign companies who also print money for dictators. And Canadian Tire. And people wonder why we're in a major economic crisis. Look at the system.
Set a bad talking.
good news for Canadians is we're slow to get into the slowdown, and we will likely be quick to get out of it, because our country basically is solid.
I mean, we have a highly regulated industry that has been remarkably successful and has an enormous amount of stability and has a lot of federal controls in.
We met with the chief economist from the Royal Bank, who said that the States is trying to move towards a Canadian banking system to give it more stability.
Is the whole world on stupid pills? This much debt is nothing to be proud of. And now countries around the world, including the United States, want to emulate the Canadian banking system? They're in for a shock. Because the government's in debt, students are in debt, farmers, teachers, parents, artists, everyone. And a wise man once said, poverty is the mother of crime.
Well, I guess I would look at it a little bit differently, because the banks are publicly traded companies, and many of these banks, when you look at pension funds, RSPs, RESPs, things along those lines, the banks make money, and then they pay it out to shareholders. It doesn't just, you know, disappear.
Well, $24 billion just disappeared from the Canadian pension plan. But that didn't stop David Dennison, president and CEO of CPP, and his executives from pocketing millions of dollars in bonuses. Or how about the $40 billion that just disappeared from the Quebec pension company?
People like to say, oh, the bad banks, they're making too much money. But it actually, in the big scheme of things, it's a good thing that companies make money. That's how the whole system is based. That's how people's retirements, their investments, that's how it works.
So when our banks are doing bad, our pensions are at risk. And when our banks are doing good, our pensions are still at risk. Gotcha. Why don't we just fix the monetary system? I'm sure all the time, work, and trillions of dollars Canadians would save would more than compensate for the banks not screwing everyone over, just to maybe get a pension. And in return, the quality of life for Canadians would improve tremendously. We would have more time to spend with our families, more time for our hobbies, and all the other things we love in life. And if you're a workaholic, you'll be glad to know that you'd be receiving more rewards for your labor, since we won't be slaving over usury debts anymore.
From what you're saying is that we could have the country that is the most highly advanced country in the world, because we wouldn't have a debt if we took these issues into consideration and try to make some changes.
That's right. And if your concerns are for the environment or underprivileged countries, imagine the differences you'd be able to make with billions of more tax dollars a year going to that cause. But the reality is, we're a sinking ship. So how on earth can we save others if we can't save ourselves?
You know, like if I were running this country, you could pretty much say to the banks, well, we're not paying you back. Like, if you don't like it, get the f*** out of the country.
Yeah.
So where am I going with all of this? Well, if we take a look at the preamble from the Bank of Canada Act, it states that the bank exists to regulate credit and currency in the best interests of the economic life of the nation. But since we own the bank, and it obviously isn't operating in the best interests of the nation or its owners, there's clearly a conflict of interest, and this needs to be looked at very seriously. Because every country uses the same sort of banking system, and this system is bankrupting all the countries that use it, the governments of the world are surrendering themselves to the international banking institutions. The World Bank, IMF, and BIS. These institutions have a history for supporting dozens of military dictatorships with billions of dollars in loans, and also wreak havoc on developed and underdeveloped countries, including our own.
So, for instance, why do we have a healthcare crisis now? We have a healthcare crisis in 2009 because in 1994, the International Monetary Fund wrote a report to the government of Canada that said, and at that point we were in debt. Remember, this was right before Paul Martin's slaying of the deficit.
So yeah, it would have been like 600, 500 billion.
It was, and the IMF's report was, okay, Canada's not, you know, we're not saying you're a basket case, but our view of your financial viability, and that of course translates into how the bond raters in New York take our financial viability. We would think, you know, we think you'd do better if you did the following things. Stop student bursaries and convert them to interest-bearing student loans. Cut the CBC, cut the NFB, cut Via Rail, reduce the number of hospital beds you've got. Now, all of those things happened. There was never any democratic debate about it. We lost 20% of our hospital beds in Canada in the year and a half after the IMF report to the Government of Canada. But nobody even really knows it happened. The World Health Organization knows it happened because they've actually done reports on Canada as one of the only modern democracies to have deliberately slashed its health care provision in order to slay a deficit. And it's proven, the World Health Organization studies prove that in doing that, we actually made our healthcare situation, not only is the healthcare worse, but the costs of healthcare went up because people couldn't access timely healthcare when they needed it before it became a disaster. So,
but who was in charge? Who actually made those cuts?
Paul Martin. We were told by the IMF that certain things should be slashed. Now, why couldn't a government say to the IMF, go fly a kite? Well, simple reason. Once you have indebtedness to a foreign country or foreign banks, and your credit rating really matters. If you drop from a AAA credit rating to a AA credit rating, as you guys know, your interest rates are going to go up on the debt you have. So you'll be spending more and more and more out of the federal treasury or in the provincial treasury. And that's why Bob Rae, by the way, as Premier of Ontario, didn't keep his campaign promises. He didn't keep them because he got to Ontario and discovered that if he did the things he promised, bond raters in New York, anonymous people, nothing to do with Canadian democracy, would make a decision to drop Ontario's credit rating such that any promises Ray was trying to keep would come from a smaller and smaller and smaller amount of an available budget, because more of his budget would have to go to paying interest on the debt. So they have you over a barrel. So once you have a debt, particularly to external sources. Now, why, you know, if you have a debt to the Bank of Canada, it doesn't matter. If you have a debt that is external, that the rest of the world is looking at, how large is your deficit? How large is your debt? How much trouble are you in? I mean, look at the United States right now. It's the biggest debtor country in the world. China holds most of the paper.
Despite of all of this, Jim Flaherty, like his predecessors, is bowing down to the World Bank institutions, which will continue to surrender our currency to international bankers. People who none of us have ever voted for. And as we've learned from our own Prime Minister Mackenzie King,
once a nation parts with the control of its currency and credit, it matters not who makes that nation's laws.
Pope Benedict XVI is calling for a new world financial order. In the third encyclical of his pontificate, Benedict denounced the profit-at-all-cost mentality of the globalized economy, and he lamented that greed brought about the worst economic downturn since the Great Depression. The document, entitled Charity and Truth, was released just hours before the G8 summit gets underway in Italy.
And at the G8 summit, the president of Russia presented what he called a united future world currency. He told reporters, "Here it is, you can see it, you can touch it."
The pontiff stressed that he is not opposed to a globalized economy, saying that if done correctly, it has unprecedented potential to redistribute wealth around the world.
I don't know how many economics classes the Pope has attended, but I can assure you, these are the kinds of crucial steps necessary to establish a one-world government, which last time I checked, conflicts with Canada being an independent sovereign country. In closing, we must regain control of our country's currency from the private banks, both domestic and international. If our governments can make the laws that give away our currency, then they can make the laws that take it back. And while we're at it, maybe the Bank of Canada's logo should finally be changed to a Canadian maple leaf. After all, a good mother knows when to let her child leave the nest. Sorry, Britain. And if we truly love our country and our children, we'll do something now to save them from a life of debt slavery. I mean, you wouldn't want to borrow money from the mafia and leave the debt to your kids to deal with. We always hear about transparency in government, but we never really see it. And if we did, It would probably scare the living hell out of us. How many of you can identify this man? His name is Paul Desmarais, but you can call him the Canadian Monopoly Guy. His family owns and operates Power Corp, one of the largest corporations in Canada. Power Corp owns a dozen companies ranging from financial institutions to newspapers and media, oil and energies, and more, that produce revenues of $24 billion a year and several hundred billion dollars in assets. But his most powerful investments by far are not in world resources, but politicians. Well, what do you think a man's intentions are when he owns a monopolizing corporation called Power Corp? Just some of his employees consisted of three of Canada's longest-running prime ministers in recent years, Pierre Trudeau, Brian Mulroney, and Jean Chrétien. As a matter of fact, Paul Desmarais' son, André Desmarais, now co-owner of Power Corp along with his brother, is actually married to Jean Chrétien's daughter, France. So you can only imagine how close these two powerful families are with many years of history. Other employees for Paul Desmarais are former premiers of Ontario and Quebec, William Davis, John Roberts, and Daniel Johnson. Or how about John Ray, brother of Liberal NDP Bob Ray? John is currently executive vice president for Power Corp and was longtime advisor to Jean Chrétien, as well as his campaign chairman. There's also former president of Power Corp, Maurice Strong. After becoming a successful businessman with Power Corp and Paul Desmarais, he was able to bridge himself from business to politics with his new circle of friends. He became first executive director of the UN Environment Program and president of the World Federation of UN Associations. Remember, this is a businessman. Some of Maurice's friends include the likes of the World Bank president, James Wolfensohn, former vice president of the US, Al Gore, and former Swedish Prime Minister and member of the Global Governance Institution, Ingvar Carlsson. And last, but certainly not least, Paul Martin. Paul became president and CEO of one of Power Corp's subsidiary companies, the Canadian Steamship Line, which was eventually sold to him in the 1980s. During his ownership of the Canadian Steamship Line, Martin changed the flags on the ships in order to operate shell companies in overseas countries like Singapore and the Bahamas, where he could exploit the laws to profit from cheap labor, lower environmental standards, and paying virtually no income tax on revenues of several hundred millions of dollars. After giving his steamship company to his kids, in 2003 he was fit to become Prime Minister of Canada and tell everyone else to pay income tax. And in January 2004, the Canadian federal government revealed that Martin's Steamship Line Company had received over $100 million in federal government contracts, grants, and loans since Martin became finance minister in 1993. This was the same time he was cutting taxpayers' dollars to our schools and hospitals in order to slay the inescapable debt. You can bet with gifts like these, Martin would have to remain pretty loyal to the man who established his family fortune and political success, Mr. Monopoly Man. I mean, Paul Desmarais. And how many of you even knew his name? Some of Paul Desmarais' other friends include the Bush family, the Clinton family, and the President of France, Nicolas Sarkozy. When you consider the circle of friends surrounding Paul Desmarais, it's not hard to imagine how government corruption can set in. But it's our government officials who should never be this infatuated with making money and powerful corporate allies. And yet, sadly, we see exactly that. And this is just the tip of the iceberg when you consider these next things. Bilderbergers. Not Bilderberger, but members of the Bilderberg Group. The Bilderberg Groups consist of some of the largest visible corporate, political, and royalty members of the world. They hold their meetings annually, usually in remote places where there's no media allowed, at least to broadcast what goes on, because there's plenty of members of the media attending the meetings, such as Chairman of the Board of the Washington Post, major media outlet owner Rupert Murdoch, and news anchor Peter Jennings. Some of the other members include presidents of the United States, such as Bill Clinton and Gerald Ford. Bankers attend, of course, World Bank President Wolfensohn, Alan Greenspan, Chairman of the Federal Reserve, and Timothy Geithner, President of the Federal Reserve, and somehow became U.S. Secretary of Treasury. He looks confused about it, too. That would be like the president of RBC becoming our finance minister. It just reeks of corruption. Dozens of corporate giants sit in as well, such as the CEO and chairman of Google, the CEO of IBM, and the chairman of Nokia and Shell. And who could forget the hard-working royal families? Prince Charles of England and Queen Sophia of Spain. Both go to Bilderberg. And wouldn't you know it, Pierre Trudeau, Jean Chrétien, Paul Martin, and Stephen Harper have also all attended.
What is your opinion on these secretive meetings that I hear about of the Bilderberg group that comes time to time in Canada, and they get together, I think, once a year, random places kind of in the world?
Well, I don't like that, and I don't like the Canadian Conference of Canadian Executives, Tom DeQuino, being part of it. I mean, they meet in Banff and behind closed doors to sell out Canadian sovereignty by saying, you know, Canadian business is for sale.
I don't know why these people, why they're meeting in the first place. You can't tell me, they can't. Nobody can tell us why. Maybe they're talking about wallpapering the walls. Who knows, right?
Well, they're so secret that they, you know, I just say in general, I don't think any good comes of meetings that are secret. There's democracy really thrives in sunshine, and things that are anti-democratic do best under rocks, right? So if you keep things out of the public eye and they're not accountable, that's concerning. Obviously, if you're negotiating a peace agreement, the doors are shut till you come out. I mean, that's a good thing. But generally, people know what's going on. These meetings are so secretive that nobody knows what's going on. And similarly, the Security and Prosperity Partnership meetings, where the only people allowed in the room are governments and business leaders. That's anti-democratic. I don't like things that are anti-democratic.
Bilderberg meetings, have you heard of this?
I've heard about them. I don't know what that is. I mean, I've secret society type meetings, and they discuss. I recall one being at a place where I went with a friend in Ottawa. I'm trying to think of the place. It was a hotel outside of Ottawa.
Right. Was that just 2 years ago?
Yeah, it was actually, I was up there because one of my good friends was getting married. We went to a Neil Young concert that night, and the next day it was all these people were moving in, security and everything. It's the Bilderberg conference. So
again, like our previous prime minister, or current prime ministers have attended these meetings and don't really talk about it. Do you think there would be something to be worried about, though?
No, not necessarily. I mean, if to put the scenario forward that you're talking about, if the 100 top people in the world invited me to a meeting, do you think I'd turn it down? Probably not.
I've never been invited, so naturally I'm suspicious.
It's an interesting group, but I can't firmly say that I don't know that I know nothing about it. I mean, I've heard what it could mean. I listen to Richard Serrett from time to time on CFRB at 10 o'clock at night. I don't know, but I'd certainly like to learn more about it. But it is apparently behind closed doors.
I'm suspicious of those meetings.
Were you ever invited or?
No, they know my views about it.
In 1996, Paul Martin and Jean Chrétien, among other Canadians, attended the Bilderberg meeting held in Toronto, King City. The building picked was naturally a $66 million resort, which was then owned by CIBC Bank. Some of the other members that attended that year were Ted Rogers, Chairman, President, and CEO of Bell Canada, Chairman of Ford Motor Company, everyone's favorite Conservative Premier of Ontario, Mike Harris, Conrad Black, owner of many newspapers, and just recently sentenced to 78 months in a U.S. federal prison for wire fraud and obstruction of justice. Chairman of CIBC Bank, President of the National Bank of Hungary, David Rockefeller, Chairman of the Chase Manhattan Bank, and many, many more. But for those of you who don't know the Rockefeller family, they have a bit of a nasty history of playing Monopoly in America, as well as being a major supporter in the creation of a one-world government. But don't take my word for it. Listen to David Rockefeller himself. We are grateful to the Washington Post, the New York Times, Time Magazine, and other great publications whose directors have attended our meetings and respected their promises of discretion for almost 40 years. It would have been impossible for us to develop our plan for the world if we had been subject to the bright lights of publicity during those years. But the world is now much more sophisticated and prepared to march towards a world government. The supranational sovereignty of an intellectual elite and world bankers is surely preferable to the national autodetermination practiced in past centuries. I wish I was making this stuff up, but if you open up page 405 in Rockefeller's own autobiography, he states that, "For more than a century, ideological extremists at either end of the political spectrum have seized upon well-publicized incidents such as my encounter with Castro to attack the Rockefeller family for the inordinate influence they claim we wield over American political and economic institutions. Some even believe we are part of a secret cabal working against the best interests of the United States, characterizing my family and me as internationalists, and of conspiring with others around the world to build a more integrated global political and economic structure. One world, if you will. If that's the charge, I stand guilty, and I am proud of it." I bring this up because this man attends the same secret meetings all of our leading government officials do.
Now those are the three issues that I'm working on. You may have others. Let's hear from them. You may not agree with me. Let's hear that. That's a lot more fun. And let's just talk about where we're going. Thank you very, very much.
I was able to catch up with Paul Martin on this topic at the University of Waterloo with a youth group I was a member of called Future Canada.
This was about, I believe in 1996, you attended a meeting called the Bilderberg meeting, and as I think you were Minister of Finance at the time. Not many people know about the Bilderberg meeting. I try to speak to people about it and they think I'm crazy or that it doesn't exist or anything like that. Namely because it's not really widespread in media, and in fact a lot of media representatives actually attend the meetings themselves, and they just choose not to disclose the information and context of it. I'm just wondering, in 1996 when you attended, like just details, like I mean if you could explain like who invited you, why did you go, what were your thoughts on it?
Well, I can't remember who invited me, but I remember going once. Bilderberg meeting is a meeting of very influential people around the world. Canada, at that point, was considered a third world basket case. We were in trouble under our eyeballs, and I had to go, I essentially went to common markets, went to them and say, look, we're getting our act together, and it worked.
Okay, well, one of the members of the Bilderberg meeting actually, sir?
Are you not going to take questions from the floor?
Okay. But just one thing about that Bilderberg meeting is that one of the attendees named David Rockefeller, and I heard you talking earlier about this global financial crisis that everyone's involved in, and just like Stephen Harper said, that possibly this is going to be as bad or worse than the Great Depression in 1929. And not many of us have actually lived in those times, so we don't know what we're actually facing, but it could be pretty bad. And one of the members of the Bilderberg meeting stated in the Bilderberg meeting that we are on the verge of a global transformation. All we need is the right major crisis, and the nations will accept the new world order. And this is someone who attended the same meetings as you, and no one really knows about it. In fact, actually, most of the last four or five prime ministers we've had have attended these meetings too, Stephen Harper, John Kitchen, and so on and so on. And I spoke to John Turner, a former prime minister as well, who didn't attend, and I asked him what he thought of it, and he said very specifically that is basically a group of businessmen who get together behind closed doors and sell out Canadian sovereignty. He said he didn't like them at all and he was very skeptic.
Well, it may well be at the meeting that I went to. I can't remember if David Rockefeller was there. There was no question of Canadian sovereignty. But what there was a group of people. This was the year that the Wall Street Journal called Canada essentially a banana republic, said that we were a third world country and we were going down. And I've got to tell you that my first couple of years as finance minister, I did nothing but go around the world basically saying, but Canada was going to turn it around. We did. We did it. Within 4 years, we had the best balance sheet of any country in the world.
So what is your opinion about it?
It's really good. It was really, really good stuff.
Yeah, I don't know if the system did he come over? And
yeah, he told me to, like, because I don't know what it was. He just said that I could ask no more questions. Yeah, that's what his chief of staff told me.
That's what I thought. Yeah,
I think it was felt there was a little bit of an attack on him, to be honest.
Yeah.
And so he said, like, if he's going to ask him more questions, that he would just have us more leave.
Okay, if you're an RCMP officer, could you care to explain why Canadian tax dollars are going to protect this guy instead of putting him behind bars? He's conspiring with international bankers in secret who openly talk about world domination via major world crises, on top of participating in the largest theft ever committed in our country's history. And when confronted about all of this, he acts like a child and has his chief of staff remove my microphone. Is this any way for a Prime Minister of Canada to act? Surely this is newsworthy. Good thing CTV was there to catch the footage.
University of Waterloo, an unusual send-off. While most students kick off Reading Week with a party, a large crowd gathered to get a chance to talk with former Prime Minister Paul Martin. CTV's Nicole Lampa is here with this story. Nicole, what did they discuss?
Kyle, given that Martin was a former finance minister, the economy was the key discussion.
Every country is focusing on what can they do in order to stimulate their national economies.
A worldwide problem is being felt by these students.
What can we as the West?
Matthew Castle asks a former prime minister and finance minister how to survive the economic downturn, not just as a student, but also as a future leader.
As a young person, I'm going to be inheriting this economy. I'm going to be inheriting the budget deficit that Stephen Harper is now racking up. And I think it's important for me to be informed so that I can make good choices and make good decisions.
When you have someone that has done it in the past and effected change, you know, be it whether you agreed with the way he did it or not, it really inspires you to do something.
Others feel the same way.
It's just interesting to hear someone of this caliber speak on these kinds of issues.
He can tell us a lot about what's going on. He has a ton of perspective. He was a fantastic politician.
In my experience is that you can't judge these crises, and they are normally worse, which is why you've got to keep your, as a country, keep your balance sheet in surplus, and you got to make sure you have the room to maneuver.
The economy wasn't the only topic. Martin also talked about Canada's treatment of Aboriginals, our role in Africa and Afghanistan. For Matthew, these are issues he doesn't mind tackling.
I think when times are tough, that's when you're most needed. And if I would have something to contribute, I'd be more than happy to do it.
Now the talk was put on by UW's Federation of Students and a Canadian youth group.
This is one of the most disgraceful pieces of journalism I've probably ever seen. Nicole Lampa refused to talk to me on camera, and later after watching the program she put together, I asked her why she didn't at least give the name of my youth group who arranged the whole event in the first place. She told me she was under the impression that my youth group's name was A Canadian Youth Group, and then quickly hung up the phone. In fact, the most coverage that my cause had received from the whole event was published in the local Waterloo paper called The Record, where it was written that, and of course there was that one passionately idealistic student who grilled Martin relentlessly until the microphone practically had to be wrestled from his hands. By the way, I'm not a student at the University of Waterloo. I can't afford it. But again, poor journalism. So here we have the guy who writes the laws, and one of the guys who abuses the laws, which is bankrupting the entire country. getting together in his $66 million private resort in secret, along with other bankers who admit major crises are used to form a one-world government ruled by bankers and elitists. You see, Paul Martin doesn't care if he helps bankrupt the people of Canada, because he's already made his millions from the guy who practically made him prime minister. But instead of exposing this, these two news agencies did the opposite and made Paul Martin look more like a saint. This is the opposite of information. Misinformation. So now do you see why the owners of the media attend these secret meetings as well? They don't want to expose the truth, because if they did, they would expose themselves. Take this copy of Reader's Digest, The Canadians You Trust. Let's check out who made the list. Stephen Harper, number 8. Michael J. Fox is number 5. Wayne Gretzky, number 12. Queen of England is number 2. She's not even Canadian. But I guess simple facts don't matter when you're a major publishing company. Number 1 was David Suzuki. Mr. If you can't beat Walmart, join them. Bob Ray is number 29. Shania Twain, 30. Don Cherry is number 14. What's going on here? How is this list even put together? If you read the fine print, it states, to conduct our trust poll, we commissioned an independent research firm, Harris DeSima, to survey a representative sample of nearly 1,200 English-speaking Canadian adults. Respondents were presented with a list containing the names and photographs of 100 prominent Canadians and asked to rate each according to trustworthiness. They were then asked to select which personality they trusted the most, giving us our list of the 50 most trusted Canadians. Wow! What an informative study! That's just a loophole to get away with publishing a magazine titled The Canadians You Trust, and then putting Stephen Harper and other corrupt politicians on the list. Because what they should have called the magazine was Canadians Nearly 1200 People Trust from a pre-selected media biased list of figures used only to spread propaganda. I mean, who has the power to tell you who to trust, other than yourself? Well, apparently Reader's Digest. But wait a minute, I thought CNN was most trusted. Maybe that was based on another elaborate trust poll, where CNN wasn't on the list. Here's a quick word fact. The literal translation for the word entertainment is diversion. Ah, it all makes perfect sense now. Because people are more worried about how Jens still can't get it together, inch by inch these global elitists are getting closer to their goal of world domination. Thanks, Rick. You know, I always had a feeling you would be involved in the destruction of the world. The media is doing such a great job at convincing everyone that politics in Canada is as simple as red versus blue. When in reality, as we've seen behind closed doors, they all belong to the same clubs, all serving the same corporate masters. Consider politicians like a box of Smarties. All different colors on the outside, but on the inside, they're all full of the same crap. When people get sick of red, blue steps in to give the illusion of democracy. This game goes back and forth for years and years and years. Sometimes we get a little bit of hope from orange or green, but because they don't have the powerful corporate backing behind them like blue and red, they'll never get into power unless they sell their souls as well.
It's not so bad. It's a little bit sour, but
Oh, well, maybe these ones aren't as bad.
But democracy isn't only a joke in Canada. Let's hear a good knee slapper from Al Gore, former vice president of the superpower of the world, the United States.
I am Al Gore. I used to be the next president of the United States of America. I don't find that particularly funny.
Pretty good material, eh? He just cracked a joke about the widely known fact that George Bush Jr. had rigged the 2000 US election. That's a former vice president of the United States joking about democracy not working. And one has to seriously wonder, why didn't Al Gore make a movie about the US election being rigged by the biggest laughingstock president the world has ever seen? I mean, to me, democracy being a joke is much scarier than climate change, especially since that he would have had much more power to fix things as president than just some guy with a slideshow. But it didn't really bother Al Gore since he's in the club as well. So it isn't his position to actually do what's right, but rather to do what he's told. Which is why the joke is funny. The real sad thing, though, is the audience thinks they're laughing with him. This is the reason why pro-voting ads are sponsored by the government and are practically shoved down our throats. They want us to play into the game that gives them the power to control us. Look, if voting really made a difference, our monetary system would have been fixed by now. So without further ado, let us introduce the new Smarty of Canada. Count Ignatieff.
But he's kind of quirky. Like, as a human rights expert, there's a lot of his writing that suggests that some people are entitled to human rights and others aren't. Mm-hmm. But the essence of human rights is everybody's entitled to human rights. So it comes from his experience of being Russian royalty. His grandfather was an aide to Tsar Nicholas. And one of the only families that escaped from Russia from the Bolsheviks was the Ignatievs. And he's got good, like, he's got this kind of aristocratic, almost royalty attitude.
Michael's grandfather, Count Paul Ignatieff, was senior advisor to Emperor Nicholas II of Russia. He also served as his last minister of education. Why the last? Because as a result of the Russian Revolution in 1918, the whole royal family was arrested and executed. Except for Michael Ignatieff's grandfather, who was apparently released by a sympathetic guard and fled to Canada. Count Ignatieff's son George grew up to become a Rhodes Scholar, worked in the Department of External Affairs, became a permanent representative to NATO, also became Canadian ambassador and president of the UN Security Council. Finally, when Michael was born, opportunities were paved in front of him by his family, and he was able to attend and later teach in universities across the world, such as Oxford, Harvard, Cambridge, University of London, and a lot more. As a matter of fact, Michael Ignatieff has spent half of his life outside of Canada, becoming educated and prepared for bigger things. In 2004, Ian Davey, son of the Canadian Senator Keith Davey, and a lawyer, Daniel Brock, both Liberal organizers, went to the United States where Ignatieff was teaching at Harvard still, and told him that it was time for him to establish himself in Canadian politics in order to become Prime Minister. And in an ultra-rare occasion, Ignatieff was crowned Liberal leader half a year before the Liberal convention was held. But again, this shouldn't be a surprise to any of you by now, since we know they're all buddies behind the scenes. Ignatieff released a book this year in April called True Patriot Love, in a sad attempt to look like a Canadian patriot. But just writing a book and declaring something doesn't make it true. You can't judge a book by its cover. But it does conveniently add to the deception. So as Canadians, we've lost ownership of our money and our democracy.
Well, at least we own the largest brewery in Canada. Well, second largest brewery.
Third largest?
Well, who needs beer when I got my Tim's anyway? What the?
How about our railroads? Highways?
What the fuck?
The construction and land value of Highway 407 comes to $107 billion, which was then sold by Bilderberg Premier of Ontario, Mike Harris, for $3 billion to Austrian and Spanish corporations in order to generate money for tax cuts.
So wait a minute. We sold something worth $100 billion for $3 billion to save money. Well, that just makes perfect sense.
Because all that $3.5 billion did, it just bought down a deficit number.
Yeah.
The 1 year, I mean, it was one year where you get the spike and you get the benefit, and that's it. Talk about short-term thinking.
The 99-year lease contract allows these foreign corporations to charge us whatever they want to drive on our own highways. The government is not allowed to build a competing highway as well. Well, there's got to be some things that we still own.
Okay, let's look back at what we sold again.
But not only are Canadian companies disappearing at alarming rates, the Canadian jobs are as well. You see, the system we have is so tightly knit that one domino falls and it affects the rest of them. For instance, about 90% of GM Canada's production goes directly to the United States. And as a result of the planned US economic crash, these are some of our most reliable customers now. If they can't even afford their homes, how are they going to afford our cars?
In my opinion, this is a direct result of decades of unfair trade. For decades, offshore competitors have been allowed to saturate our market with their vehicles with no limits in place. Approximately 5 million vehicles a year come into our market from offshore, and we can't enter their markets. And if we can enter their markets, there's restrictions put on us, such as South Korea, where last year they exported 400,000 vehicles to our market. We are allowed to export 300 vehicles to their market. I just left the workplace yesterday morning. That's been in Oshawa since 1937, PPG Glass, where 160 people were told yesterday they don't have a job in March of 2009, a direct result of our conservative government doing nothing in regards to unfair trade, because most of the glass coming into our country now for vehicles is produced in China. And we can't compete with Chinese labor, Chinese wages. We can't compete. Colin Carey, this is his city, this is Oshawa. 11,000 good paying jobs have left the Oshawa area in the last 2 years, while Colin Carey has been our voice in Ottawa. Jim Flaherty should be ashamed of himself. He comes from Oshawa Whitby. So, he represents this sector.
So do you think all these jobs that are being lost, are they gone for
good? They're gone for good. They're gone forever. It's a lot like collective bargaining. Once you give something up, or once you lose something, you're not getting it back. We lose these jobs, they're not coming back.
And once again, we see the domino effect come into play.
For every one assembly line job in General Motors up the street, it creates 7.5 in spin-off employment. So you've heard that they're going to close our truck plant next May now instead of July. 2,600 jobs are going to evaporate out of that facility. But then if you look at the spin-off employment, it's more around 14,000 jobs are going to be gone throughout this region as a result of that plant closing. The auto industry in Canada employs 440,000 people between auto assembly, auto parts. That's a lot of good paying Canadian jobs at a time where we've lost well over 400,000 jobs in the last 4.5 years because of the manufacturing crisis. So if you put all your eggs in one basket, this is a crisis. It's unprecedented. It's the worst time in our history. And that's why I'm offended that our government continues to turn their backs on this crisis.
So what are the main reasons for the auto industry crisis? Once again, we come back to the monetary system and our government leaders selling Canadians out.
It's troubling, and I get frustrated because none of this has to happen. None of this has to happen. You know, it's a cycle where the industry has its ups and downs. We've all seen it, any of us that have worked in the industry for a number of years. But never have we seen this much uncertainty, never.
It's becoming more evident than ever that the jobs in Canada are shifting from manufacturing to consumer-driven. This means bad times for working people and good times for corporate monsters like Walmart, who make profits from violating human rights.
Sorry, how is Walmart violating human rights?
Just listen to the workers themselves.
We really work day and night in order to get the wage of less than $3 a day.
I would respectfully like to ask the boss of Walmart to give the Chinese workers some consideration and a chance for a little time off.
Customers of Walmart, when you wear expensive clothes, when your children play with high-quality toys, think about China and the Far East.
Those profits you made and the wonderful life you have are the sweat and tears and overtime working of Chinese people.
If one day I encounter a lady who just bought a toy from Walmart, I'll say, respectable customer, respectable Walmart customer, do you know why you can buy such a cheap toy from Walmart? That's because we workers work all day, every day and night.
But I mean, the only problem there is that if you look, it's not just Walmart. I mean, if you look across the board, most of the products we get come from places where this happens.
So most of the products that Canadians are subjected to buy come from slavery-backed companies that our governments have allowed to grow and monopolize in our markets. And it doesn't really seem to bother anyone. Which is why Walmart's low prices are wiping out Canadian businesses. I mean, how is any company in Canada supposed to compete with this? You can't. That's why Walmart is so successful. They know that if they had workers like this in Canada, no one would stand for it. So they go to a country like China, where they can get away with it, bring the goods back to Canada, slap a happy face logo on the product, and sell it at marked up prices. But still lower than any honest made product from Canada, because it costs them so little to make the product itself. Letting a corporation operate like this in our country is a danger to Canadian jobs, human rights, and it's just plain wrong. But our government doesn't really find it to be an issue since over 20 Walmarts open in Canada every year. And when economic times are tough, not only are we practically forced to shop at Walmart, but it's only these big guys that can keep their heads above water and take the economic hits. This means we'll all be working at Walmart and shopping at Walmart and dying at Walmart. But what is the most powerful business of all? You see, as horrible as the bankers and corporate elitists may be, they're nothing without the law giving them their powers. This is why our money is technically legal tender. It's the law's money. The law then creates laws that imperfect man will inevitably break. I called up my municipality and asked them why was it illegal to park between 3 and 5 a.m. on a residential road. They said it was because of snowplows and that they usually come between those hours. In September? They thought it was funny too. The point is, this is a guaranteed cash cow. Here's another quick word fact. The word bench literally translates to bank. So when you hear that the judge sits on the bench, he actually sits on the bank. Interesting. Because the law gives the banks their power, and the way banks operate creates poverty. And since poverty is the mother of crime, the law makes a killing off of poverty-stricken people and ridiculous fines and court fees, which all have to be paid back with their money. Quite the business scheme, I must say. But I'm not saying that all laws are bad. I'm just saying that if there's one thing the law has taught us, it's that if you have money, the law is on your side. Because everything is about money. Think about all the rich people who get off the hook simply because of their wealth. I mean, really, what's a $200 speeding ticket to someone who has millions of dollars? Nothing. It's no wonder why everyone wants to become a millionaire, because then you can get away with whatever you want. And ironically, it's the law that has taught us this. So go ahead and break the law if you have money. Or if you write the law itself. For instance, our former Prime Minister Brian Mulroney accepted $300,000 cash in New York and Montreal hotels. None of the money was accounted for, and none of the money was taxed. Anyone else in Canada would probably have been jailed, but not Mulroney. You see, the last time the RCMP accused Mulroney for doing shady business in 1995, it cost them and taxpayers millions of dollars because they had hurt Mulroney's feelings by calling him a crook. So he did exactly what you would expect from a Prime Minister of Canada to do. He sued them. But could you see these kinds of events happen to anyone else in Canada? Fat chance. As a matter of fact, the Montreal Police Brotherhood said officers were recently told by their superiors to increase the amount of tickets issued from 18 to 28 tickets a day. The Montreal Police Union president told CTV News that there's only one priority for the City Hall. That's giving tickets, bringing more revenue to the City Hall instead of fighting criminality. The union went on to say that the increased quota mark was due to a $13 million budget cut.
The Honorable Stephen Joseph Harper. L'Honorable Stephen Joseph Harper.
Moi, Stephen Joseph Harper, je promets et jure solennellement et sincèrement qu'au mieux de ma compétence et de ma connaissance, j'exécuterai loyalement et fidèlement les pouvoirs et je m'acquitterai des responsabilités qui m'ont été confiées en qualité de Premier ministre, ainsi Dieu me soit en aide. I, Stephen Joseph Harper, do solemnly and sincerely promise and swear that I will truly and faithfully, to the best of my skill and knowledge, execute the powers and trusts reposed in me as Prime Minister, so help me God.
So there you have it. Banks, governments, and law. Originally all great things, but they have all been hijacked from the people and used as tools to establish a one-world totalitarian government.
Let me close just one more thing on this question of sovereignty. Very difficult for a large country to accept that somebody is going to come in, like the United States or like the Europeans, and is basically going to come in and say, you're not doing your regulation in a proper way. Fair game. But what's going to happen when China and India are economies as powerful as the United States or Europe? And what's going to happen when there's a mortgage meltdown in India? What's going to happen when a Chinese hedge fund goes under? And that the results of that tsunami don't stop at the Chinese or the Indian border, but that in fact you find them in Idaho and Iowa and California. Who's going to deal with that unless we're prepared to understand that in fact we're all going to have to give up a little bit of our sovereignty in order to make the world work? I hope that that also is something that the G20 comes to deal with. So those are the issues that I've got to deal with. I think that we are really at the beginning of a very different era. 1944, the great minds of the world, Dexter White, John Maynard Keynes, and a bunch, essentially laid the foundations for the Bretton Woods institutions in the United Nations. And they built a system which functioned for over 50 to 60 years. I think that it's time to renew that vision. A very different world than one that dated in independent nation states who simply came together but could ignore essentially what was going on inside those countries. That day is over, thanks to Alan Locke. I think we've got to take it one step further. And we've got to say that, in fact, countries have responsibilities to their neighbors. And their neighbors are in every nook and cranny of the world. And I believe that that is going to become the debate of our generation. And it's one that I'm very happy to share with you. Thank you very much.
If there's one thing we've learned from history, it's that no one can resist the pursuit to conquer the world. And as we know, history repeats itself. So how unrealistic is it to think that nothing has changed in the last few decades? And isn't it funny how all of these rulers were able to convince their people that they were the good guys? What's the most effective way of establishing a one-world government? Order out of chaos. Create a crisis, and then the solution that favors you. Take our deliberate economic crash, for instance. It's the worst in our world's history, but when you see how the monetary system really works, it's clear as day why the world banks just happen to be the ones to pick up the pieces. They're people we never voted for, but do attend secret meetings with our world leaders, bankers, media members, and corporate billionaires. As dire as all of this looks, remember everyone, the government is servants of the people, not the other way around. They work for us. So do the patriotic thing and don't vote this coming election. As we've seen, it doesn't matter which way you go. Strategic voting, or lesser of two evils, read the same thing on the ballot. Don't do it. So what do we do instead? Just pick up the phone. Imagine every day the government receiving phone calls and emails from the same number of people who voted last election, but this time demanding changes to be done concerning the topics of this film. The government staff would be overloaded and will be forced to deal with the real issues. This would be true democracy, not this. So call now. This is the most effective approach I see, because protests are basically just a group of people who don't know what to do. And all it takes is for one idiot to turn violent, and before you know it, things get out of control, people get hurt, and nothing gets done. So don't do it. If we can peacefully fix these issues from the comfort of our own homes, why not? And if you're the leader of another political party, quit waiting to be elected and join the real solution. You should know by now that the first step in becoming Prime Minister is make friends with Paul Desmarais. Here's yet another quick word fact. The word parliament, when broken up into its two French words, literally means speak and lie. Well, of course. So please, if you're watching this, get up and do something. It would only take a few minutes out of your daily lives to really help out your country. If you would like to support the people who brought you this film, there are numbers of ways to do so. Raise awareness. Spread this movie around. Burn copies of it, email the video, whatever you have to do. In fact, the Toronto Film Festival is right around the corner. Maybe a viewing there would be helpful. Or if you're the CBC or some other news agency, could you consider donating some broadcasting assistance to the youth of Canada that brought this film together? We seem to be doing your job anyway, so a little bit of help would be very appreciative. Or if you're in the law enforcement departments, please, just remember who you're supposed to protect, and your job's to keep peace and protect us from evil, not to make a business from the misery of others. Maybe try to create some kind of substitutions for certain fines, where people could repay the debt with community service instead of dollars. At least then they're directly repaying the community. We also believe that people everywhere should be free from food and energy crises. With all the technology and hardworking people we have at our disposal, there's no reason why we should all be so reliant on the businesses that control our most basic necessities. We would like to see homes and farms debt-free and self-sufficient so that families aren't at risk with or without the crises we may be facing. I realize most Canadians are strapped for cash with the current recession, but this is where you influential and wealthy Canadians can really make a difference. Besides, in a depression, there won't be anyone buying your CDs, Avril. or anyone going to your hockey games, Crosby. Well, Jim, if you don't want to help your own fans and country, have fun when hyperinflation hits and your piles of money that you love so much turn into piles of toilet paper.
It's hockey night tonight. Tension grows, the whistle blows, and the puck goes down the ice. The goalie jumps and the players bump, and the fans all go insane. Someone roars, Bobby scores at the good old hockey game. Oh, the good old hockey game is the best game you can name. And the best game you can name is the good old hockey game. Second period, where players dash with skates aflash, the home team trails behind. But they grab the puck and go bursting up, and they're down across the line. They storm the crease like bumblebees, they travel like a burning flame. We see them slide the puck inside, it's a 1-1 hockey game. Oh, the good old hockey game is the best game you can name. And the best game you can name is the good old hockey game. Third period, last game in the playoffs too. Oh, take me where the hockey players face off down the rink, and the Stanley Cup is all filled up for the champs who win the drink. Now the final flick of a hockey stick and a one gigantic scream. The puck is in, the home team wins the good old hockey game. Oh, the good old hockey game is the best game you can name. And the best game you can name is the good old hockey game.
Don't tell me Canadians can't help each other out. If you would like to support our causes, here's the contact information to help out with donations or any other kind of assistance. The bottom line is, if we do nothing, we could be in very serious trouble. So just make a phone call. Or lend a hand. Because the future of our country depends on it.
Oh, Canada.
From true morality,
from far and wide, oh Canada,
we've lost our sovereignty.
Wait, and free steak, baby.
God keep our land.
Hopefully debt free.
Canada, we have no dignity.
Oh, Canada, what's left to stand?
Right.